So Mama Mia is lying on the carpet right next to me because I'm recording upstairs because of the load shedding and we have some battery lights upstairs. Jedediah is very confused about the change of location and the kittens are playing around in the dark downstairs. But Mama Mia has decided that she's going to keep me company. And so good morning, everybody. As you noticed from the video clip, I'm upstairs because of load shedding. And it's still lovely to be with you, and I do want to greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus and say from our home to yours a very warm greeting and welcome to you as we worship together. It's been a full and busy week for me. We had the Global Leadership Summit on Wednesday. We had the memorial service for Rona Scott on Friday. And then on Saturday, a wedding service for Dana and for Vivian. And what a lovely moment that was. You can see a photo of them here as they're lighting the central candle together, the candle that symbolizes their new life together with their children. And it's our prayer for God's blessing on them as they begin their new life together. As we worship together, we're going to be looking at a very beautiful idea that comes to us from John chapter 11, and it's all to do with life. And the fact that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And so our call to worship comes from John chapter 10. Jesus said, "The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly." Let's worship God together. Let's join together in prayer. Lord Jesus, we come into your presence this morning, celebrating the fact that you are the life giver, that you are the source of our life. Our life, our hope, our strength is in you. And we turn to you this morning to recognize you as the God who we worship, for your majesty and your might, for your love and for your grace. We bask, Lord, in the beauty of your creation. We are comforted by your presence and your guidance. We are relieved by your mercy and your forgiveness. And we are strengthened through your providence and your sustenance. And we know that in you we live and breathe and have our being. And Lord, as we come to you, we want to declare that you are our God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God without beginning and God without end, and you are worthy of our worship and worthy of our praise. We confess to you, Lord, that we have sinned against you in word and in thought and in action. And we can make up excuses, and very often, Lord, we have promised that we wouldn't do something and then we do it again. And Lord, we recognize that we are broken, we struggle. And that we don't want to do, we end up doing. And that we should do, somehow we neglect. Forgive us, Lord. Thank you that Jesus' blood washes away our sin, that we are restored and renewed and made new in Christ. We are so grateful for the cross and what you did for us there. And we glorify your name, now and forevermore. Amen.
Introduce you to my friend Pam. She does puppet shows at another church. Hello, Pam.
Hello, Liz. Thank you for inviting me.
It's a pleasure. We were talking about animals in the Bible. And Pam, what is your favorite animal?
Well, I can tell you what my least favorite animal is.
What is that?
An elephant. I'm really scared of elephants. But my favorite animal is a giraffe.
Why a giraffe?
Well, I'm short and giraffes are tall. I want to be tall like that one day. And they're also very peaceful animals. Did you know each giraffe has different patches?
Wow, that's amazing. So each one is slightly different.
Yes, they're unique, just like us.
Wow, I wonder if giraffes are in the Bible. I know that lions are in the Bible, like Daniel in the lion's den, and serpents are in the Bible in the Garden of Eden, and even dogs licking Lazarus' wounds. Do you have any dogs, Pam?
Yes, I have two dogs.
What are their names?
Their names are Tiger and Lexi. Do you have dogs, Lex?
Yeah, I also have two dogs. His name is Boris and the other one, Zoe. And to get back to the animals in the Bible, I think there's a lot of animals mentioned in the Bible. And I think what is important, even in Revelations, Jesus rode on a white horse when he comes back to earth. And in the old days, there were also donkeys.
Oh, wow, I like donkeys.
So in Eastern tradition, it says a king rides to war on a horse. And if he is going to a town in peace, he goes on a donkey.
Hmm.
Isn't that amazing?
I never knew that.
I think the donkey might be one of God's favorite animals.
Why?
Well, if you look right in the beginning of time, Abraham used to ride on a donkey. Joseph and Mary, when Mary was pregnant with Jesus, rode on a donkey going to Bethlehem.
Oh, yes, I remember that.
Yes. And even when Jesus was born in the stable, that's the home of a donkey. And the donkey, I'm sure, was there with the other animals in the stable. And remember his triumphant entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday.
Yes.
He was on a colt, which is the foal of a donkey, which is a baby donkey.
Aww.
Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
Well, there's one other important thing with regards to donkeys. Did you know the donkey is the only animal with a cross on its back?
Really? A cross?
A cross, just like Jesus. When Jesus died on the cross for our sins, the donkey that rode Jesus in on Palm Sunday also has a cross on his back. I think Jesus or God wanted to mark the donkey as a special animal.
Wow, that is why his special animal is a donkey then. I have a new favorite animal then. My favorite animal is a donkey.
Wow, that's amazing. And I think that is one of the animals that are not looked after as other animals, because people don't think it is as important as a horse or other animals.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we must remember, when we see a donkey again, we must look for the cross on its back. And remember, Jesus is peace. So he came with peace like a donkey. And Jesus was born in a stable and died on a cross for our sins, for all of us, so we can be saved, just like the donkey's mark on the back. But I wonder how people will be able to tell if we have a mark on us. I'm not sure. I think maybe it's in our hearts. Our mark of Jesus is on our hearts. Don't you think, Pam?
Yes, I think if people look at you and they see that you are friendly and that you are helpful, then they know that Jesus is in your heart.
Absolutely. Wasn't that a wonderful discussion? Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer. We thank you for the animals that you have given us, our dogs. We thank you for the donkey, Lord. We thank you for elephants, lions, and giraffes, Lord. Lord, we know that there's a special meaning that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and that the donkey carries the mark of carrying Jesus into Bethlehem. Lord, we ask that you will grow the mark in our hearts, that we can become friendly to people and show them that all Jesus' good doings. This we ask, not that we deserve it, but by your grace and your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wow, thank you, Les.
It's a pleasure.
I love learning new things about the Bible, and especially the poor little donkey. That was very interesting.
Thank you, and we hope to see you again soon.
That will be nice.
Good luck and good blessings at your church too, Pam.
Thank you, Les.
Okay, bye.
Our scripture reading is a well-known one, John chapter 11, the story of Lazarus. And we probably remember it for John 11:35, the shortest verse of the Bible, Jesus wept. But this chapter is about some of Jesus' closest friends, Lazarus, Martha, and Mary. And Jesus shared a really close friendship with them. The chapter starts off with drama. Lazarus is sick. The urgent call goes out from the sisters, "Hurry, your friend is sick." Jesus inexplicably delays. He delays to the point that Lazarus dies, and he tells his disciples that Lazarus has died, but that he is going to raise him from the dead. And so they return to Bethany, and there Martha confronts Jesus with her intellectual struggles, with her heartache and her pain. And Jesus talks with her and unpacks some beautiful truth with her. Then Mary arrives and they go to the graveside together, where unexpectedly we're told that Jesus wept. Commentators suggest that he wept out of sadness and compassion and out of empathy, that he weeps because he feels the pain of Mary and Martha and their friends that have gathered together. Other commentators suggest that these are hot, angry tears, as Jesus contemplates the grip that death has over us. And so he commands that the stone be rolled away. Martha objects because she says Lazarus has been there for 4 days, it's going to be smelly. But Jesus gets his way, the stone is rolled away, and he cries out, "Lazarus, come out of there." And Lazarus is raised from the dead. This is so explosive, and the news of Lazarus' resurrection becomes so public that Jesus' enemies have to accelerate their plans to execute him because they realize he is becoming too popular. The passage that we're going to listen to is just a short section from this whole chapter, but I think it holds the key verses and the key thoughts. It's Martha who is in her grief stage, the grief stage that we call bargaining, where she's trying to figure out what could and couldn't happen and what could, what should and shouldn't have happened. And as she's grappling with all of that, her faith is at that point that's like an engine that you're trying to start, and it's sparking and sputtering and struggling to take. And it's in this space that Jesus talks to her. Let's listen to God's word.
John 11, verses 17 to 25. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?"
Let's pray. Father, as we have listened to your word, we pray that you would help us as we unpack it and try to apply it to our lives. Be with us in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For Mary and Martha, I think it felt like death was winning. Lazarus gets sick. Jesus doesn't get there in time. And in fact, there are rumors that he delayed, that he dilly-dallied, that he didn't come as quickly as he could have. The burial was 4 days ago. And people are still around them, still with them, still weeping and crying. And theology seems a pretty cold comfort at this point. And we see Martha comes to this place where she's wrestling. On the one hand, she has faith. God will give you whatever you want. Almost an implication that maybe Jesus could still do something. But then just a few verses later, when Jesus asks them to roll away the stone, there she is saying, no, don't do that. Because if you do, it's going to smell bad. He's been in there 4 days, Lord. And so it feels for Martha, and I think for Mary and those there, it felt like death was winning. You and I have been there too. We have lost loved ones. Or we've heard that the cancer is back. We see the ongoing violence, poverty, and crime all around. We wrestle with a tanking economy, marriages that are failing, depression and anxiety that overwhelm people, and the list goes on and on. But God would speak into this situation where it feels like death is winning. And the story of Lazarus is an amazing moment in John's gospel. We know that Lazarus is raised from the dead, but he'll die again. It's not as though Lazarus stayed alive forever. And in fact, we hardly ever hear of Lazarus again. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, why does John make such a fuss? Because Actually, just in a few chapters, John will be talking about the resurrection of Jesus. And doesn't the resurrection of Jesus just totally trump the temporary resurrection of Lazarus? Why would John pay so much attention? Why would he give a whole chapter to the story of Lazarus being raised from the dead? Now, very often, to answer that question, we center on John 11:35. Jesus wept. And we point to the empathy and the compassion of Jesus, and that this is at the heart of this chapter. But there's more to this chapter than that. And I think to find the answer for that, the key lies in the verses that we listened to this morning. The answer that Jesus gives to Martha when she comes with her prepackaged pie in the sky one day when you die faith. When she says, oh, I believe in the resurrection one day. Jesus turns around and he says, I am the resurrection and the life. And I'm going to take a quick digression there, just for a moment. Because in John's gospel, there are seven I am statements. And these statements harken back to Exodus chapter 2, where God introduces himself to Moses as I am who I am. And so in John's gospel, there are seven key verses in which Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, or I am the bread of life, or I am the light of the world. And this happens seven times. What's fascinating is that here in John 11, the story of Lazarus, we encounter the fourth I am, the middle I am. And this I am statement is Jesus' response to Martha's canned theology and her pie in the sky, delayed into the future, her theology that has an eschatology far distant from her. And as he responds to her, he offers her something much more than one day when we die. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. And if you believe in me, you will never die. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die in eternity. It's a powerful statement that Jesus is making. And in this moment, he's telling Martha that he is resurrection, but also that he is life. And then, as they go to the gravesite and his tears flow, he goes on to prove that he is resurrection and that he is life. And in this beautiful chapter, Jesus is saying, life wins. Death doesn't win. Life wins. Because I am the life bringer. I am the one who conquers death. And I hold life in my hands, not only in eternity, but here and now. And so there's some critical lessons that we need to learn from this encounter of Lazarus, this resurrection of Lazarus, this raising of Lazarus. And we recognize that life wins, even when frailty invades, even when those that we love get sick, even when the unexpected happens, even when we're overwhelmed by our frailty. Secondly, life wins, even when our expectations aren't matched, even when things don't turn out the way we thought they would. Martha and Mary thought that Jesus would come running and come to the rescue. They didn't even imagine the even better and bigger thing that Jesus planned to do. Life wins, even when things don't go our way or the way that we expected them to. Thirdly, life wins, even when we're angry and heartbroken, even when we're wrestling, even when our faith is sputtering and struggling. Life wins. Fourthly, life wins when things get a little smelly, when those all around us will say, it's hopeless, it's over, it's not going to happen. And Martha says, don't roll the stone away because it's going to smell. Life wins. Life wins. And fifthly, and maybe this is the most important, life wins even when it isn't permanent. And what I mean by this is the fact that Lazarus was raised from the dead, and then would one day die. And the point about this is that not everybody who was dying or had died got raised. And not all of Jesus' friends got raised either. Throughout his lifetime, Jesus must have attended many funerals, seen many who had died. But life wins even when we're surrounded by brokenness, even if the fix is only temporary, even if there is a change in our situation and then later on things go downhill again. Lazarus would grow old. Lazarus would become frail. Lazarus would one day die. But in that moment, as he walked out of that tomb, he knew deep inside of him, life wins. No matter what life throws at us, no matter what death throws at us, life wins. Life wins. And so the beautiful comfort of this passage is that we are given a picture here of how Jesus steps into a situation of death and brings life. But you know, life doesn't always win in big and dramatic ways by raising somebody out of a grave. Sometimes life wins when hope is rekindled. Life wins when a cup of water is shared with someone who is thirsty. Life wins when a grudge is dropped and forgiveness is offered. Life wins when death is faced with courage and with faith. But here's the big secret. The life that we're talking about is not the universe or chance or fate. The life we're talking about is found in only one being, and that is Jesus. Life is found when we put our trust in him, when we put our hope in him. True life is found nowhere else. And Jesus will echo this elsewhere when he says, I'm the bread of life. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'm the light of the world. Life is found in him. Life is found in the one who comes to us. The one who speaks to our pain. The one who goes to the graveside with us. The one who weeps with us. And in Romans 8, we read, Paul talks about the Holy Spirit, who when we're in trouble, prays for us in groans that words cannot express. Life is found in our God, who gives us resurrection and life. Life is found in the one who calls life out of the grave. And life is found in the one who, although he was the resurrection and the life, would go to the cross and there would let go of his life. And it's John who makes this so clear to us as he says, Lord, into your hands I commit my spirit. And he gives up his spirit. You see, his life wasn't taken from him. He gave his life for us. So let me conclude. And maybe the way to do this is to say, so what's broken, dead, or smelly in your life? Seriously though, in what places are you being overwhelmed by death? In what places do you feel as though death is winning? Because Jesus wants to remind us that life wins. That life wins. That when we put our trust in him, if we really believe in him, he offers us life. Not life without trouble. Not life that is necessarily comfortable. But life in him. And that whether we find ourselves at the graveside, whether we find ourselves wrestling with our faith, whether we find ourselves contemplating something that is so broken that it seems to be getting all smelly, that we recognize that God is able to bring life. And sometimes it's for a season. Sometimes it's a moment, and then trouble comes again. Sometimes we journey with people who have cancer, and then there's great rejoicing when the cancer goes into remission. And then after a season, the cancer comes back. And people say to me, but then what was that all about? And this is the secret. Life comes, and sometimes it's just for a season, to remind us simply that life wins. That when all else fails, God steps in and does what we cannot. But it's not forever, because we're not made for this life exclusively. There is a life ahead of us that we must go to. But while we live on this earth, while we live in the midst of brokenness, life keeps coming. It comes in the answers to prayer. It comes in the miracles that we sometimes experience, the big ones and the little ones. In the healings that we receive, but also in the grace that we experience, a kind word, a thoughtful gesture, an action that breaks down walls and tears apart the boundaries and breaks chains, that brings life. And Christ is at the heart of it all. It's His love. It's His grace. It's the power that is in Him that He unleashes on a broken and tired world. And He brings life. If I think back carefully, this last week has been filled with moments big and small where I've seen life at work. In a funeral service, the power of the scriptures that remind us that death has lost its sting. In moments of counseling where a marriage has been in trouble and just a bit of encouragement has changed everything. In a situation of grief and depression, where just taking time to listen has brought peace, and a word of hope has been taken on board, and life has changed. Life is at work in us, and that life is found in Christ. And in a world that keeps telling us that death is winning, the resurrection of Lazarus and ultimately the resurrection of Jesus would beg to differ. Life wins. And so I want to finish with a song by Ed Kerr and Jerry Williams of a group called Harvest. And it's called I Am the Resurrection and the Life. In the song, they put Mary in the song, and it really is Martha that Jesus is having this conversation with. But the song also reflects some of the doubt of the disciples in some of the other passages that we find in the Gospels. But ultimately, the song is really talking to you and me. And it's our names that need to go in there. And so I want to invite you to listen to this song. Feel its power. Feel the truths that it's offering. Feel the hope that is conveyed in the music and in the voices. But most important of all, grasp the truth of this central I am, that Jesus would look you and me in the eye and say, I am the resurrection. I am the life. And in me, life wins.
This wouldn't have been. And Master, if you'd only answered, I know he wouldn't be dead. Mary, if you'd only listened to all the words that I've said. And Mary, if you'd only trusted, you'd know he isn't really dead. Can't help what you're saying. I'm so weak, and I know you'll never come home. And Master, I know someday I will see him, but my faith could never roll back his stone. Mary, how long will I be with you? You might understand. And Mary, don't you know that I can cause all these graves to rise again? For I am the resurrection, I am the life, and he who believes in me, though dead, shall not shall not die, because I am, because I am.
We respond to God's word in the offering, and while we can't hand around a physical offering bag today, we can still do the most important part of the offering, and that is giving God ourselves. So let us pray together. Dear Father, you have given us everything we have, and we respond to your word and your love today by offering ourselves. We give you our hearts. We give you our time. It is a gift from you and best used serving you. We will serve you with the talents you gave to each of us. We give you our treasure. You are our gracious provider. And we pray that you will use these gifts to grow your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word that we have been able to listen to this morning, and the power of your word that would speak into the situations of deadness that we see all around us. And Father, in our tiredness and in our exhaustion, as the year is winding down and we're dead tired, we're just out of energy and out of strength, and where we feel like we're fading and depleted, your word comes to remind us that when we trust in you, when we walk with you, when we hope in you, we will find strength. And so we thank you, Lord, for your word and for the blessing that you bring with your word. And we thank you, Lord, that you have surrounded us with life. If we would just open our eyes and see it, that you have surrounded us with evidence of your life, beating and pulsating throughout our day-to-day experiences. May we see it, embrace it, and share it with others. We pray for our country, for our people. We think of our politics, we think of our economy, we think of the coronavirus. We think of those that are struggling, either with their physical health or their emotional health. We pray for marriages and we pray for our children. We pray for every situation where death is bullying us and trying to tell us that death wins. Help us to proclaim the life that we find in you. And so, Lord Jesus, thank you for stepping into Mary and Martha's situation, walking up to their graveside and reminding us that life wins. Amen. really lovely to be with you this morning. And I do pray that the message this morning has warmed your heart, strangely warmed your heart, that you would look to Jesus and experience the life that pulsates from him and from his love, that you would be warmed by it, and that you would pass that life on to all who you encounter. Three quick announcements that I need to make. The first is a reminder of the Global Leadership Summit. We had the first installment of that this last week on Wednesday, and Brenda and I set aside the time, and we absolutely loved it. It was fantastic. And I heard one of my top five talks in 12 years in the talk of Albert Tate, and I shared that in the check-in. But it really was so meaningful and exciting. And I'm hoping to try and set up the 4th of November that we can do it at the church, and that if you'd like to come and be part of a group that watches those presentations together, that we can do that. And so watch this space. And then a reminder of the Scripture Union Camp for our young people. The details are on screen, and I do encourage you to consider that. And then for our teenagers, this coming Friday, I'd love to have a chance to get together with you. It's a controversial weekend. It's Halloween, and Halloween has all sorts of connotations of death in it. And so the message today is really appropriate because life wins. And so we're going to have an un-Halloween gathering where we celebrate life rather than darkness and brokenness and the ghoulishness of death. We're going to celebrate life. We're going to recognize just what a blessing God brings to our lives. And so young people, keep your eyes posted. I'll let you know the details. But I'm looking forward to spending some time with you. And so that brings us to the end of our service today. I do pray that God would be with all of us in this week that lies ahead, and that we would be agents of life and resist the temptation to fall into the cynicism and the negativity and the refrain that death seems to be winning, that we would choose to put our trust in Christ, who is the resurrection and the life. So go in peace, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and remain with us, now and forevermore. Amen.
These are the birthdays and anniversaries for this week. Today, Hangwani is having a birthday. On Monday, Tina Kaku, who is turning 9, and Liam, who's also turning 9, have their birthdays. On Wednesday, the 27th, it is Connor's birthday. Thursday, the 28th, Louisa and Craig share a birthday, and on Saturday, Barbara Ann has her birthday. Then there are two anniversaries this week. Today, Dale and Donnie are celebrating their 6th wedding anniversary, and on Thursday, Eileen and Joachim are celebrating 43 years of marriage. Let us pray for these folk. Father God, we thank you so much for these special people in our lives. We pray a special blessing on them this week. May they draw closer to you on their special day as well as in the years to come. Please bless them and guide them. Show them your love. We ask this in your precious name. Amen.